Good afternoon. Today is February the 15th, and it is 2:18 in the afternoon. We're going to start off with Psalms 36. Psalm 36 is about wickedness of man and loving kindness of God. The wickedness of man and the loving kindness of God. This was written by King David to the chief musician, a Psalm of David, the servant of the Lord. The first four verses are black for sin. And it says, "The transgressions of the wicked saith within my heart that there is no fear of God before his eyes." Lord God, this is so true today. People pretend as if God is just a three-letter word and that he no longer ranges here. But God is still in charge. It is God, the reason why we have a new president. It is God, the reason why we have yet to have our woman president. It is not something that he wants. And if we continue in those things that we insist are good for us, you will find out that it is the most drastic change in the history of the presidents, and it will have a terrible impact on the nations. Our enemies will be upon us with a blink of an eye with a woman president. And you could say you heard it here on Spiritual Water. So if you're ready for disaster upon the earth, keep on wishing for that which shall not be, okay? It says, "The transgressions of the wicked saith within my heart, there is no fear of God before his eyes." This is the wicked, not the righteous. 2, "For he flattereth himself in his own eyes until his iniquity be founded to be hateful." He flattereth himself in his own eyes until his iniquities are found to be hateful. 3, still black, "The words of his mouth are iniquity and deceit. He has left off to be wise and to do good. 4, he devises mischief upon his bed. He setteth himself in a way that is not good. He abhorreth not evil." He abhorreth not evil. This means that he does not hate evil. Okay, the wicked will not ever hate evil. Evil is their lifestyle. And the Lord's words are their enemy. Okay, including any of the Lord's servants. 5-9 is purple for the Trinity. 5, "Thy mercy, O Lord, is in the heavens, and thy faithfulness reaches unto the clouds." 6, thy righteousness is like the great mountains, thy judgments are a great deep. O Lord, thy preservest man and beast. 7, "How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God." That is with an exclamation mark, America. "How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Therefore, the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings." 8, "They shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house, and thou shalt make men drink of the river of thy pleasure." Hallelujah. 9, "For with thee is the fountain of life. In thy light shall we see light." 10 and 11 is orange for your faith. "Oh, continue thy loving kindness unto them that know thee, and thy righteousness to the upright in heart." I'm going to repeat that because I'm speaking for those of us who are here on earth who truly, truly worship the Lord. "Oh, continue thy loving kindness unto them that know thee, and thy righteousness to the upright in heart." 11, still orange for your faith. "Let not the foot of pride come against me, and let not the hand of the wicked remove me." That's right. "Let not the hand of the wicked touch thy anointed." Father God. And 12 is black. There are the workers of iniquity falling. They are cast down and shall not be able to rise up. Yes, the Lord will slowly, one by one, remove those that are in the way of those he has set in place. So if you are among those that are gathering up people so that you can go against the president for what he's trying to do, his job, let it be known that God will soon or later get tired of you. And in the midst of your wickedness, as he has done in the biblical time, he has opened up the ground in the biblical time and swallowed up thousands of people all at one time. Ladies and gentlemen, you will hear it happen here in the United States, 2017, in the midst of protesters. The windows of hell will open up and crack the ground that they are standing in, and there will not be enough help to rescue them because they will be swallowed up as they were swallowed up in the biblical days. So, yes, continue to protest, and you will see, because this nation now, they believe not anything you say, and the only way they will believe it is when it is actually happening to them, okay? And do not have any pity for the wicked when they get what they deserve. They will get what they deserve. Surely, as my God's name is Jehovah Jireh. We will be reading from, we are still in the topic of the wrath of God. And one thing about the wrath of God, I told you yesterday that it was abiding. Well, I'm telling you today that it is accomplished. What does accomplished mean? It means to fulfill. The Lord's words and deeds will be fulfilled. His promises will be fulfilled. Okay? A, of God's words concerning Judah's captivity, that was fulfilled. In 2 Chronicles, Judah's return, Daniel's 9, that was fulfilled. God's sovereign plan, Isaiah 55, that was fulfilled. The Messiah's advert, God's sovereigns, Isaac 55, that was fulfilled. The Messiah advert, Daniel's 9, that was fulfilled. Christ's suffering, that was fulfilled. Okay, in Luke's 18, Christ's death, that was fulfilled. Okay, final events written in the book of Revelation, every last word will be fulfilled. Okay, so his wrath will be fulfilled, America. Let it be that you'll be on the right side and not be among his sheep and not be among his goats. All right, be among the sheep of God. Don't be among the goats of God, because we all know where they'll end up. Okay, so we're going to be studying today Revelation 6. And in Revelation 6, it talks about the Lamb opens the seal. First, second, third seal, fourth seal, fifth seal, and 12th seal. Okay? But before we read, since this might be my second time doing the book of Revelations with you, I don't recall doing an introduction to the Revelations with you. Now, this was written by John the Apostle. John the Apostle, the favorite one among the disciples of Jesus Christ. He had three that he favored. He favored John, he favored James, his brother, and he favored Peter. Okay, those were the ones who he had with him at the Transfiguration. Those three were also the one that he had with him at the Garden of Gethsemane. Okay, so this John is the one who wrote the book of Revelations. All right, written between AD 90 and 96. Between AD 90 and 96, the title. This book is so named because it is the revelation of Jesus Christ as given to the Apostle John. It is called the Apocalypse. There has been a book written on it. I have not read the book yet, but from my understanding, the book is good. It is called the Apocalypse, which means revelation or unveiling. Unveiling. Background. John is exiled by the Roman government to Patmos, a small island off the coast of Greece, for preaching the word of God. His exile is part of an intense period of persecution against the church, which allows the Roman emperor Domitian proclamation that he should be washed up as deity. While on Patmos, John receives this revelation about Jesus Christ from God the Father. An angel helps John to understand the vision. Whereas the first book of the Bible, Genesis, tells of the beginning of sin and Satan's triumph, the last book of the Bible, the Revelation, tells of sin's end and Satan's defeat. A special blessing is promised to all who read, hear, and obey this book. So all of you who are hearing this book being read to you, there is a special promise for us, okay? Because we are reading it, we are hearing it, and we are going to try to understand it, and we are going to definitely obey it, okay? So a special blessing is promised to all who read, hear, and obey this book, but also a special curse is promised to those who add to or take away from these words. How can you add to or take away from these words? When you take this any chapter of any book in the Bible and you cherry pick through that chapter, that is taking away from it. If that chapter has 36 verses, you are not to pick one or two or three verses from any chapter. Read that. Go to another book. Grab a few verses from there. Read that. That is evil. Because you are not giving the Lord's people the full plate he has prepared for you. That's like having a plate with meat, rice, vegetables, and you take a toothpick and you just take a little pinch off the meat and you take a little grain of rice, whatever you can hold on a toothpick, and that's what you feed the people of God. That is sinful, because the words are meant for you to read from the first verse to whatever the last verse is. This is how you feed the people the full plate that God has prepared for them, okay? And this is why you see so many pastors and servants of God are now on their downfall or in their graves because they have failed to do the job according to the way it's supposed to be done. It's called Moses-itis. It's the same thing Moses did. Moses was told to speak to the rock. That was his instructions. Speak to that rock. The Lord wanted to show his might once more to this wicked nation of people that he had rescued from the Pharaoh. But Moses allowed his temperament. He allowed his temperament to get in the way of him obeying the exact instructions given unto him. And that cost him much. It cost him much. Very, very sad story. He had done a great thing. And because he allowed his emotions to get in the way of what he was supposed to do, he was supposed to be doing for God, he paid an awesome price for that. So please, let us not be like Moses in that sense, where we're not listening to his instructions, okay? This is why here at Spiritual Water, you will be read to from the very beginning of whatever chapter we're reading to the very end. We don't do skippity-doo here at Spiritual Water. It's not allowed, okay? No skippity-doo, all right? And a special blessing is promised to those who read, hear, and obey this book, but also a special curse is promised to those who add to or take away from these words. John also wrote the fourth gospel and the three epistles which bear his name. Where written on the island of Patmos in the Aegean Sea, as we said earlier in the introduction, that he was exiled to that small island. So there is where he got the revelation, and there is where the angel came to help him understand that which he was seeing. To whom? To the seven churches in Asia Minor, modern Turkey. It is modern Turkey now. In the biblical time, it's called the Asia Minor, but today it is modern Turkey. Okay? Contents. The revelation is a lavish and colorful description of the vision which proclaimed for us the last days, which we are in the last days, ladies and gentlemen. America, before Christ returns, and the ushering in of the new heaven and new earth. The fact that it may at first seem too complex is no reason to avoid this book. This book is a scary book, ladies and gentlemen. It is scarier than any horror movie man has ever made. This is a scary book, and it's even more scary when you read it and you associate it with all this going on in this world today. It is very, very scary, so brace yourself before reading it on your own. Okay, for it is the fact that it may at first seem too complex is no reason to avoid this book. For it is a full disclosure of the prophetic events which await every person. It's every person, ladies and gentlemen, America, every person, okay? Whether you are a believer or not, whether you have another person or God that you worship to, every person will experience the effects of this book. They will experience it. Okay, whether dead or alive, it don't make no difference. The revelation reveals the series of devastations poured out upon the earth, the mark of the beast, 666, the climatic battle of Armageddon, the binding of Satan, the reign of the Lord, the great white throne judgment, and the nature of the eternal city of God. Prophecies concerning Jesus Christ are fulfilled, and concluding call to his lordship assures us that he will soon return. And he will not return in the same way that he came the first time. He will not return in a woman's womb. No. When he left here, he was a 33-year-old man. When he returns, he will be 33 years old still. And he's been gone for many, many years. Many years. Okay? He will come back in the same way that he left. So when you see the thundering that strikes all the way from the west coast to the east coast, you see that lightning strike from the west coast to the east coast, it's that day. Okay? When you see earthquake, when you hear earthquake all over the earth, it is that day. We don't know if it will be today, tomorrow, next week. But it will be a scary day on earth. Why do I get teary now? Because if we continue at the rate we're going, many will perish on that day. Many. And I would rather see all those people repent for their sins and be saved than to perish. I would rather see you live than to die. Okay, continuing. Key words in the book of Revelations. Revelation. Jesus Christ, 7. This book is a thorough revelation of the total person of Jesus Christ, his glory, power, and wisdom. Okay? His judgment, kingdom, and grace. Okay? And the Lamb of God, from Alpha to Omega, several numbers have significant symbolism in the revelation, but the number 7 is dominant throughout the 7 letters, 7 seals, 7 trumpets, 7 signs, 7 plagues, 7 dooms, and 7 new things. Let me tell you, America, we can't fight God. We can't fight God. I don't care how big you make a dam, like the one in California. You can't make a dam big enough that God can't destroy it. You can't make anything strong enough that he can't rip it apart. Okay? The theme. What are themes? I tell you this all the time. PowerPoints, facts that don't need to be proven. It's a fact that if you are born a female, you are a female for the rest of your days. If you are born a male, you are a male for the rest of your days. It doesn't matter what you have allowed a surgeon to do and transform you into. You are still what you are, a female. I don't care if you're taking hormones and you call yourself John instead of James. You are a female in the sight of God and in the sight of all those that belong to him. You are still a female. Okay? That's a fact. Okay. Here's the first fact from the book of Revelation. The end of life, earthly life, is only the beginning of eternal life. Yes. Your time here on earth is short and brief. Your life thereafter is for eternity. So, depending on how you live your life here on earth will determine which eternal household you will end up in. You only have 2 choices, and they both begin with H. The first choice is heaven, where our Lord resides. The second choice is hell. Choose which one you will prefer. But as this life is real to you, your eternal life will be even more real. And you cannot come back and warn nobody, because as the Lord says in his book, he will have servants here trying to warn them. You cannot cross over. All right? Second, Christians shall spend eternity with God in the New Jerusalem. Hallelujah. That's where my home will be. In the New Jerusalem. All right? Hopefully many will join me. All right? Christians shall spend eternity with God in the New Jerusalem. Unbelievers shall spend eternity with Satan in the lake of fire. Choose life or death. Your choice. Okay? God desires that everyone trust in his son for redemption. When? Today. And that ends with the exclamation mark, America. Today, get to know your master. Today, get to know your rabbi. Today, before it's too late. All right? Now, let's go straight to our reading. Okay, this reading is all prophecy from verse 1 to verse 16. It has 17 verses. The last verse is black, so there are only two colors in this chapter. Gold for prophecy, black for sin. And just so you know, what does that mean? I will take you back here. Prophecy includes promises, covenants, revelations, voids, visions, dreams, oaths, pledges, inspiration, fulfillment, and future. All that is covered under prophecy. Black is for sin and evil. What does that include? Evil, judgment of the ungodly, death, hell, curses, condemnation, temptation, unbelief, hatred, hypocrisy, and apostasy. Okay, that is covered under black for sin. Let's begin. Verse 1, for those who are just joining us, we are reading from the book of Revelations, chapter 6, 17 verses, starting with verse 1. And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, come and see. Second, I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. Three, and when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, come and see. Four, and there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another, and there was given unto him a great sword. Okay, that beast is here already. That beast, that horse, that red horse, and his power is here already. Look at the number and in the increase in people killing themselves among families, husbands, wives, mothers, children killing their parents, priests being killed at the altar. It's just everywhere. It's an epidemic. Okay, so that horse has already opened up that seal already, all right? And they should kill one another, and there will be given unto him a great sword. Five, and when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see, and I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. Six, I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hurt not the oil and the wine. Seven, and when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. Eight, and I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death. Okay, and hell followed with him, and the power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beast of the earth. Nine, and when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the sounds of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. Ten, and they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? 11. And white robes were given unto every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season until their fellow servants also have their brethren and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. So yes, that is part of our lot. That is part of our lot. French benefits, I call them, of spreading the gospel of Jesus. Should that stop us? Absolutely not. We are soldiers of the Lord Jesus Christ. And soldiers are always courageous. All right? 10, and they cried with a loud voice. I'll repeat that. How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? 11, and white robes were given unto every one of them, and it was said unto them that they shall rest yet for a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. 12, and I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. Did I not tell you? There was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. That's a scary sight when the moon turns blood red. Back in 2006 or 5, I saw that moon for the first time. And it was not Halloween. That moon did not look white like it's supposed to. That moon looked very orangey, reddish orange. And on top of that, it seemed like it was lower than what it's supposed to be. You could almost touch it. It was very scary, and it stopped me in my tracks because I sat there and I stared at it. Okay, so that's a very spooky sight. All right, and I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. 13, and the stars of heaven fell upon the earth, even as a fig tree casts her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. 14, and the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island was moved out of their place. That's right. You will see a mountain coming from the Blue Ridge Mountain being dumped into the Pacific Ocean. Imagine the noise that will make. Imagine the chaos it will create. Yes, your little trinket toys will not work. You will not be able to call anybody. The only person you're going to be able to call, his name is Lord and God. Let it be that he hears your call. Okay? 15. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains and the mighty men and the every bondsman and every free man hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains. 16. And said to the mountain and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. That will be the wicked begging. Okay? The last verse says, for the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? I tell you who. Those that fear God and trust him with all their heart, they will have peace in their heart upon that day. Despite what they hear, they might be a little afraid. But somehow or another, that fear will disappear and peace will take over. Okay? That is all for Revelations 6. As always, I like to take a little stroll with our master. Or I like to give you additional words according to the will of God. Faith. We read that one yesterday. All right, here goes some more. Forbidden. These are things that are not to be. Things that are happening now that are not to be. Interbreeding. Crossbreeding. You are not to crossbreed your animals. You have not, you should, the man should have never made a ligress that was crossbreeding two different animals, and they came up with a ligress. Anytime you do that, you make that animal sterile, because God did not create the ligress. He created the two beasts that you put together to make the ligress. It is forbidden for you to do this. Okay, Leviticus pertaining to the Levites in animals, vegetables, and clothing. Leviticus 19:19. Ye shall keep my statutes. Thou shalt not let any cattle gender with a diverse kind. Thou shalt not show thy field with mingled seeds. Neither shall a garment mingle of linen and wood come upon thee. These are rules given to us long ago during the time of Moses that we should still be obeying these laws. Okay, abominations, things utterly repulsive. Description of Hebrews eating with Egyptians, Genesis 43:32. And they sat on for him by himself, and for them by themselves, and for the Egyptians which did eat with him by themselves, because the Egyptians might not eat bread with the Hebrews, for that is an abomination unto the Hebrews. Undesirable social relationship, Exodus 8:26. And Moses said, it is not meant so to do, for we shall sacrifice the abominations of the Egyptians to the Lord our God. Lo, shall we sacrifice the abominations of the Egyptians before their eyes, and will they not stone us? This is why Moses insisted that they take that long 3-day journey into the wilderness, because many of the things that they were going to be speaking about was the same practices the Egyptians were doing. And if the Egyptians would have seen that, they would have wanted to kill them. Okay? Another spiritual practice, Deuteronomy 18:9-12. When thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abomination of those nations. Deuteronomy 18:10. There shall not be found among you any one that maketh his son or daughter to pass through the fire, or that which divinations, or an observer of time, or an enchanter, or a witch. You are not to be going to a palm reader. You are not to be going to a palm reader. That is evil. Okay? Deuteronomy 18:11. Or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirit, or a wizard, or a necromancer, one who inquires of the dead. Deuteronomy 18:12. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord, and because of these abominations, the Lord thy God does drive them out from before thee. Heathen idolatry, Deuteronomy 7:25-26. The graven images of thy God shall ye burn with fire. Thou shalt not desire the silver or gold that is on them, nor take it unto thyself, lest thou be snared, which means traps, okay, therein. For it is an abomination unto the Lord thy God. Okay? Understand? Abomination, things utterly repulsive. Okay, some more abomination, things utterly repulsive. I will continue to read this every time it comes in front of my face, because it means to me my Lord wants me to repeat it. Apply to perverse sexual relationships. Instruction on sexual morality. Leviticus 18:26. Ye shall not therefore keep my statutes. Ye shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgment, and shall not commit any of these abominations, neither any of your own nations, nor any stranger that sojourn among you. What are they? Leviticus 18:27. For all these abominations have the men of the land done, which were before you, and the land is defiled. The land right now is greatly defiled. Greatly defiled because of the moral because of the moral condition of the nations. They're doing all kinds of wicked things because science did not exist during the biblical time. So science, in a way, can be good when it does that which is good, when it finds a cure for a disease. But when science takes and changes a gender from one to another, that is evil. When science takes and takes two different beasts and join it together and create one new beast, that is evil in the sight of God. All right? That the land spewed you out also when ye defile it, as it spewed out the nations that were before you. Wrath of God. Yes. He can cause the earth to spew us out in any fashion he chooses. All right? 18, Leviticus 18:29. For whosoever shall commit any of these abominations, even the souls that commit them shall be cut off from among their people. Wicked. Wrong clothing. Deuteronomy 22:5. Laws concerning sexual morality. The woman should not wear that which pertaineth unto men, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment, for all that do are an abomination unto the Lord thy God. Prostitution and sodomy. Deuteronomy 23:17. There shall be no whore of the daughters of Israel, nor a sodomite of the sons of Israel. None. Okay? Deuteronomy 23:18. There shall not bring the hire of a whore or the price of a dog, which is a sodomite or a homosexual or a gay or a bisexual or a lesbian, into the house of the Lord thy God for any vow. For even both these are an abomination unto the Lord thy God. Okay, proclaiming a defiled wife. Deuteronomy 24:4. Her former husband, which sent her away, may not take her again to be his wife after that she defiled, for that is an abomination for the Lord, and thou shalt not cause the land to sin, which the Lord thy God giveth thee for an inheritance. Racial intermarriage, Ezra 9:1-14, I will read 1 and 2. Now when these things were done, the priest came to me, saying, the people of Israel and the priests and the Levites have not separated themselves from the people of the land, doing according to their abomination, even of the Canaanites and the Amorites and the Moabites and the Egyptians and the Amorites. Ezra 9:2, for they have taken of their daughters for themselves and for their sons, so that the holy seed has mingled themselves with the people of those lands. Yea, the hand of the priests and the rulers have been chief in. Okay, the rest of this part I don't have, but I think you do get the idea. This is why I said America, when God made man, he made a woman to match that man. When he made the Japanese man, he made a Japanese woman. When he made a Chinese man, he made a Chinese woman. When he made a white man, he made the white woman. When he made the black man, he made the black woman. When he made the Mexican man, he gave a Mexican woman. He made a Colombian man, he made a Colombian woman. When he made any man, he gave them a matching woman. Why? Because he wanted us to reproduce ourselves. Make more of yourselves, he said. He didn't say mingle together. Okay? I know that intermarriage is a hot thing today, and white men want black women, and black women want white men, and you have all this interracial going on today. That is sinful in the sight of God. Okay? Thank you so much for joining me here at Spiritual Waters. I hope that I have blessed you with some knowledge and wisdom of the ways of God. I pray that you will continue to read the Bible on your own and become familiar with the laws, sanctions, the commandments, and the ordinances of God, because those are more important than any man-made laws. I always say that to you. Okay, God's laws are supreme above man's laws. So if we incorporate God's laws in with our laws, we are more likely to be in his good graces, and we are less likely to commit many of the horrendous practices that we are doing today. In the meantime, I encourage you, America, to get reacquainted with our God, the God of Isaac, Abraham, the father of Jesus Christ. Get acquainted with him, because we are in the last days and much is going on, and it's going to get worse before it gets better. Okay, let it be that you are on the right side of the laws of God. Forget, I'm not saying forget about the laws of man. Yes, we do have to follow some of them, because some of them are for our own good. But the other laws that are against the laws of God, those we do not have to follow them. Okay. In the meantime, I pray that the protection of God be upon you. I pray that the will of God come from you and the peace of God be with you. Thank you very much for joining me here at Reading the Words of the Lord. This is Spiritual Water. My name is Brenda Guerrero. Have a blessed day, and thank you for listening. Thank you very much.